My name is Pitamber Kaushik. I'll be your instructor for today. Today's class is on a very novel and unique approach to vocabulary. I gave the cat in 2019, and before giving the cat, and even after giving the cat, I was working as a journalist and a writer, and I joined Bee Factory a few months back. So my cat 2019 VRC percentile was 99.91. So that's a short introduction from my end, and we can begin right away. So make sure that if you're unable to hear me at any point or you're not able to see my screen, just let me know. So today we are going to do something unique for a CAT class or for any class for that matter. We are going to begin from a blank slate, from a absolutely clear screen, because that's the point of the meeting, to teach you a way of vocabulary that can remain with you all your life, right? So don't go on the specific examples that I give. Those examples are just there to enable you to learn the method, right? So if I tell you how to integrate 2x square, you shouldn't bother about learning that particular example. Rather, you should learn about, how to perform the process of integration. So just treat it as such. Treat this class as, a demonstration rather than a specific example class where I'll give you new words to learn. I'll teach you how to learn rather than give you certain words that you have to learn. All right, so we can begin. Can anyone confirm if there is a problem with my screen? Can you see the screen clearly? If you can just drop me a yes, we can start. Can you see my screen clearly? Can you see the doc? Okay, great, thank you. Okay, let's begin right away. So let's first, so I'll tell you some theory as well, but since theory is boring, so let's start with an example right away. So let's start with a real life situation. Suppose you're solving a CAT mock, or you're reading a newspaper or maybe a magazine, right? And you come across this word. Let us take a random word that most of you would not know. Obviously, whenever I say something that is for the average, there would be someone who would know, obviously. But that is not what we are accounting for right now. All right. So let us just start with this. Let's with a particular word that we can, and we can take this forward from there. So let us start with this word, a particular word. Let's start with this word. Suppose you come across this new word whose meaning you do not know. You come across this word in a CAT passage, or you come across this word in a magazine or by reading an article. Can anyone just don't Google so that you're part of this learning process? So okay, that's correct. So some of you know the meaning, but suppose you don't know the meaning of this word. Now for those of you who do not know this meaning of the word beforehand, I'll show you how you can derive its meaning without referring to the dictionary, even in the exam itself. All right. Even in the exam itself, without referring to a dictionary or doing anything, from your existing knowledge, how you can approximate the meaning of the word enough to get the option correct. See, CAT is an exam of approximation, fairly good approximations, not finding the ideal solution each and every time. Right. So let us just try to crack this word, somnambulation. Right. So okay, if nouns are too small, just let me know, I'll increase them. So somnambulation. Now, the first thing, most of you would be reading this word in two ways. You would either be reading it as a string of letters and so on, or you would be reading it as a string of syllables like somnambulation. Both of these methods are inefficient. Don't do this. All right. So let me just try to break this word in order to derive its meaning. Let me suppose that I do not know its meaning. Okay. So let us break this word. It's somnambulation, right? So first of all, I know that shan is a suffix. Why do I know that? It's because I've seen it in multiple ways, right? I've seen it a lot of places. I've seen it in motion. I've seen it in succession. I've seen it in transaction, right? Any activity, any verb. Verbs typically contain shan, denoting an action. Even action contains the word shan itself, right? So any word, there are several words that contain this word. So I know that it is a suffix. It's not the root word, right? So I remove shan out of that equation. And now let me try to solve this word simply. Or even if you don't do this, doesn't matter a lot. The point is that shan is insignificant. So now let me try to solve it. So somn. Any of you can tell me what somn means, right? Anyone of you can tell me what somn means. So see, right now you'd be thinking that you have never come across this word. So that is quite obvious. For most likely it's Greek or Latin, right? So you would have not come across this word, but you can crack it. Yes. So whenever you do not know a word, try to find the closest sounding word that you know, the word closest to it as you hear or spell it out. Right. So what's the closest word to som that you have heard in your life, maybe something, it's something that you all suffer from. Let me give that hint. Like maybe most of you suffer from, or most of the people of your age, statistically speaking, suffer from the ailment. Yes, exactly. Excellent, Kriti. So that's the correct answer. So you all know insomnia, I'm assuming, right? So if in case you do not, just let me know. I'll explain how you can know insomnia as well. But most of you know what insomnia is. So if you know that insomnia is lack of sleep, right? If you know insomnia is lack of sleep, it's pretty simple to guess that just like inability means lack of ability, right? Inability means lack of ability. So similarly, in definitely means lack, right? So if in means lack, we can just remove it here, right? And you know, medical conditions typically end in ia, asphyxia, several conditions like that end in zia or ia. So I just removed the ia as well. So I know that basically som means sleep. You do not need to perform this exercise. You fairly everyone can guess that som part is the part that means sleep, right? So if you have figured out that som means sleep, so this is definitely something to do with sleep. So I'll just note it down here. So you don't need to do this slowly in exam. You'll obviously do it much faster. Just in your head, you can do it. But to explain to you, I'm taking this amount of time. You will obviously not take this amount of time in the exam. So yeah, that's som. Now for ambulation. Now I do not know what ambulation means, right? But what's the closest word to ambulation that you know? Anything that you know close to ambulation that sounds like ambulation, right? So yeah, okay, that's correct. Yes. So the closest word that I or anyone for that matter knows that is close to ambulation is obviously ambulance, right? So ambulance is something we have all heard of in a medical context, right? But we know that things tend to get very specific, but it generally it means something else, right? So ambulance basically refers to anything that goes from one place to another. The ambulance is a medical ambulance. It's more specifically what we call a medical ambulance, right? So ambulance is anything that goes from point A to point B. So it takes moves from it basically moves, or anything that takes you from one place to another, right? So you get the point, right? So now let me just try to fit these together. I'll never be able to find the approximate exact meaning, or maybe I can, but if I don't know a word, I can still find its approximate meaning, at least to see the options and know, okay, this option is correct, right? So now see, I know som means sleep. I know ambulance is something that takes you from one place to another. So can anyone now tell me what somnambulation means? See, I didn't refer to the dictionary. I didn't give you anything that you didn't already know, right? I used your existent knowledge to derive a word that you didn't know. Yeah, exactly. Great, Mohit. So it means walking while sleeping, right? So you see how beautifully this has come together. So without even referring to a dictionary, you have learned a new word. Yeah, Shravya, that's correct. Sleepwalking. So somnambulation simply means sleepwalking. Now, this is a fact. I know the word, but most of you didn't unless I told you. And see, you solved it, right? I didn't solve it for you. You solved it. I just guided you through the path. So now can more of you feel confident about l trying to crack new words without knowing them, right? Just use what you already know. You don't need to learn something new, right? Just use what you already know to crack a new word. So now somnambulation out of the way. Now let us try to okay. So I'll just give you another exercise. So okay, this is also a word that 90% of you wouldn't know. This is a C2 level word. So somniloquy. So now that I've told you somnambulation, so can anyone tell me the meaning of somniloquy? Yeah, excellent. That's the correct answer. But let us try to derive, let us try to break it down, right? So we know that words like lock, loquy, we have this general idea that something like logos or even locus or loqui, these may not be exact words. I'm just telling you a vague idea. Words that sound like lock. So these are related to words. Yeah, Omkar, excellent. That's quite true. So if you know any of these words like loquacious, grandiloquy, or these might be difficult words, but maybe you know one of them. And even if you know simpler words like dialogue, take dialogue for example, dialogue and monologue, right? You know that mono means one, dia means two, so that's irrelevant. Log is something, log means speaking, right? Log, dialogue, monologue, all these are acts of speaking. So you can be sure that loquy would not, and even elocution, right? Eloquent. There are lots of words that are related to speech, right? This lock and everything. So basically, I know that anything that begins with lock, log, this sounding word, this basically means speech. So I already told you that you can crack from insomnia. You know that somn is something that has to do with sleep. And now you know that from maybe dialogue or any other similar word, you know that lock or log or this lock or log or lock. loqui. These all mean speech. So can anyone tell me what somniloquy means now? Those who have told me before, it's fine. But those of you who currently cracked it, who didn't know it before. So those people who didn't know this word's meaning beforehand and they have got it now can tell me the meaning. So that would help me understand if that's effective. Yeah, okay, great. Yeah, that's very heartening to see. Okay, so talking while sleeping, right? So this is nothing but sleep mumbling or sleep talking, right? Sleep talking, simply. Sleep talking. So this is how you derive new words. So I hope you like this approach. See, the point is you might think that this approach takes time. In the exam, it won't take time. You will, over time, you will develop such an instinct. See, I never prepared for the CAT. Okay, I got VRC 99.91, but I didn't prepare for the CAT. I was working as a journalist and writing was something that I did as a profession. So I just went up to the CAT and I scored that high. I didn't even know the syllabus. I knew that there would be a section related to English. And that was just it. I even did well in maths and DILR for that matter. But okay, that's a different issue. So my point is that this approach might be slow, but it's slow for preparation, right? So if you prepare slowly, it will last much longer. So if you think that taking normal Lewis and just mugging up the words there, like 100 words that are that have no relation with each other, 100 random words, if you're mugging them up, you'll forget them within a day or two. But if you take this approach, this might be 3 times or 5 times slower than brute force. But this approach is much more lasting because you learn one root word and you connect 100 words to it, right? Or even if you don't learn the root word, you can learn similar words, right? So that is how you approach it. So let me just assume, I'll tell you something more interesting. Suppose you do not know what a particular word means. Let us take this word juggernaut. I'm assuming around 80% of you do not know this, maybe 20% of you know this, right? So suppose you don't know what juggernaut means. Okay, even those who know, just assume for a moment you don't know what juggernaut means. So what you typically do, you just look it up in a dictionary, juggernaut, and you just search up the definition, and then the dictionary goes its usual formal way, like something blah blah, this is noun or adjective or something, and then it just says that, okay, this is something something juggernaut, a very technical definition the dictionary will give you, right? I'll tell you one way that you'll never forget juggernaut. Even right now, if you open the dictionary and read it, chances are just in a week, you will forget what juggernaut means if you have never come across it before, right? No, that doesn't mean astronaut. But yeah, that's a good relation that you are trying to find, right? But unfortunately, this one isn't related to astronaut, although I'll come to astronaut later now that you have raised it. So I'll come to astronaut later. So, okay. See, now what happens? I'll tell you a way in which you'll never forget juggernaut in your life. I'll tell you in this class, you'll never forget in your entire life. I can bet on that. Okay. I'll challenge you to forget it no matter how hard you try. So see, juggernaut basically is something that came from the colonial period or from when Europeans came to India. So they saw the, most of you know what Rath Yatra is, right? Rath Yatra is a festival we have in India. So Rath Yatra is a festival in Puri where we have a big Rath or what we call a chariot, right? It's a huge chariot. It's a huge chariot. So when that chariot moves, it doesn't stop. It moves very slowly, but it carries a great momentum due to having such a large mass and size. So that people have been literally crushed under, unfortunate people have been crushed under that chariot, right? So when they saw this procession called Rath Yatra, so what the Europeans did, they heard this name, you know, the deity is called Jagannath, right? In Puri, the deity is called Jagannath. So they named it after Jagannath, they couldn't pronounce it properly. So they just named it Juggernaut, right? So it literally comes from Jagannath. So it means something that is big, huge and heavy and unstoppable. So basically, juggernaut means an unstoppable force or an indomitable force, right? Something that carries great momentum and cannot be stopped. If you have seen X-Men, there is a mutant called Juggernaut there who does exactly the same thing. His momentum cannot be stopped. So this is an unstoppable force. So now that I've told you the story behind the word, which is called etymology or the origin of the word, you'll most likely never forget it, right? So you see, this is a very effective approach. Reading the story of a word takes a few more minutes, maybe several seconds more, but it will 100-fold increase its retention, right? It will make it much more lasting. If it takes 10 times more time, it will remain for 100 or 1,000 times more time longer, right? So that is how you do this. Now let us come to someone raised astronaut, right? So, okay, astronaut, I don't know what it means. All of you know, obviously, but just to solve it. So let us see how astronaut can be broken. So we all know things like nautical, right? Or maybe, you know, knots. See, there are two things like knots. See, actually what happened when people used to measure in the sea, they didn't have something to measure. So they took a rope and made knots on it at equal interval, like literal knots. like natural knots on it, and then they used to immerse it in ocean to get a gauge of depth, how deep the water is. So from that knot, we actually got this. We got that knot, and we even got this. All three knots are related. This knot basically means zero, right? Because it looks like a zero. So knot, knots, and knots. So that's where we got nautical from. Nautical means anything related to sea. Now this same sailing parlance was taken to the space. Like an astronaut is a sailor of space. So astro basically comes from something that I'll tell you later, because that was part of my plan, but then someone raised this question. So okay, this basically means sailor among the stars. Okay, sailor of the stars, basically sailor of the stars. Now that you know that, okay, so can anyone tell me why okay, so if you don't know, aster means stars, but you, this is something that you have literally seen. It is right before you. A particular star is right before you, right before your eyes right now as we speak. So can anyone tell me where we find this aster star right in front of your eyes? If anyone can has that presence of mind. Yeah, very good. Yeah, okay, so Omkar got it correct. It's right on your keyboard. There is something called asterisk on your keyboard. If you look at your number 8 key, this is called asterisk. So asterisk is a literal star, right? So if you don't know, you can guess it from here, that aster is something that related to star. Makes much more intuitive sense, right? Makes it much more intuitive. So now that we know that asterisk is a star, we can okay, so now suppose you are a very new to English. Suppose you are very new to English, your vocabulary is absolute zero, and you come across a word like disaster. You don't know what it means. Assume for a moment that you do not know what disaster means, right? So suppose you are just trying to learn it by brute force. You just try to remember the word phonetically, just hear it in your head, and you try to mug up the meaning. So it will become very difficult. You have been taught this word since you were a child, so you think it's easy. It's not easy. It was not easy when you were first learning it, right? If you remember. So disaster basically can be broken. Now, we all know that there are things like dysfunction, or there are things like disease, basically lack of ease, right? Or anything that has dis before it means lack, negative, bad, something like that, right? So disaster basically can be split in disaster. So this basically means bad star. So if some, now this has a beautiful story behind it. Not exactly, can someone tell me why is it called bad star? Like it was originally called bad star, but it came to represent some accident or some calamity. So can anyone tell me why did something called a bad star come to represent an accident or a calamity? Remember that etymologies, word origins go all the way back into history. So try to find something from that period, like maybe 1000 or 2000 or 3000 years ago. Yeah, that's right, Kriti. Excellent answer. So see, in ancient times and even today, you see, after science has developed so much and we have learned so much, still astrology, things like horoscope and all that superstition, it continues to be a major force. So just imagine back when there was no science, how influential it would be, right? People based every decision from what they would eat to when they would wake up, when they would go out of the house, on their horoscope. So basically, there were oracles and various, in every culture, we have people who saw the stars and told their fortune or their fate or what we call luck, right? So when you had bad stars, basically you were unfortunate, right? So there was some misfortune related. If the star's positioning was not correct, like all that baloney that they used to give, that was very influential back then. So this basically represented misfortune. A bad arrangement of stars represented misfortune. So that came to represent that, okay, if there is a bad star in the sky, if the stars are not arranged well, you will have some problems when you go out. You will likely suffer an accident. So bad incidents, calamities, natural calamities, volcanic eruptions, earthquakes were attributed to bad star positions. Even personal accidents like Caesar, the death of Caesar. If you have read Julius Caesar by Shakespeare, you know that there is a point where he said among all the omens that he gets, he gets an omen about the stars not being favorable to him. There's Ides of March and all that events. So you see how we can get that. Suppose you're a native speaker and you don't know a certain word. Let's say you don't know what petrichor means, right? You don't know what petrichor means. So petrichor is basically a smell that comes after rain, right? We all know that distinctive smell that comes after rain. It's due to presence of certain chemical compounds, certain oils in the soil, which get released when rain falls on it. Now, suppose you don't know what petrichor means. Now, this can be divided into two parts. Ichor is something very complicated. Ichor is basically something you would not know. But petri is something that you can guess. Why? I'll tell you. We all know something called petrol, right? Petrol, or its full form, petroleum. So petroleum is nothing but petroleum. So this means rock of the oil, oil of the rocks, right? So oleum, something you have encountered in chemistry, right? OPH, oil of vitriol and all that. Very various chemicals have classical names related to oleum. In fact, olefins and those alkenes and everything, they are also called oleates, right? So oil, you know, oleum means oil. Like there is a literal oleum called oil also, that is also there. So petr means rock, basically that what's you. So you can connect all this together. There's a monument in Jordan called Petra, one of the wonders of the world. The study of rocks is called petrology. Right. So you, even if you know one of these, you can get all of these, right? So that's the beauty of learning etymology. If you learn one word, that creates an avalanche effect or a cascade effect, and you can link like maybe 100 words to it, right? So that is how you can learn several words together. Now, see, these are examples that I've not written somewhere. I've started from a blank screen and I'm facing the screen, so you know that I'm not reading. So I'm just giving these off the top of my head, what I've learned in my life. So just casually giving those examples. Okay. So yeah, that is there. Now, okay, so suppose let us take another word. Let's take malaria. So malaria is something, suppose you don't know what malaria is. You might get cocky here and think I know what malaria is, but then I give you a disease like schistosomiasis. And cat asks these kind of questions each year, right? Cat has a something, has something, a queer fascination with medical science passages. It gives a lot of medical science passages. I don't know why, and a lot of biology passages as well, right? So that's there. So so just treat it as an, don't treat it as an example. Just try to learn what I'm trying to tell you, even if you know what it means. Suppose I don't know what malaria means, totally confused, but I know that anything that starts with mal isn't going good, right? I know that there is malaise. Yeah, malaise, very correctly pointed out. I know there is malfunction, right? I know that there is malapropism, or suppose, no, too complicated, right? Malappropriate. Let's go with malappropriate. Let's go with malnutrition. Let's go with anything like a virus or something. Malware. Yeah, malnutrition. Exactly. Malware. Right. So mal is something bad. Like even if you know one of these words, you know that mal is something bad, right? Yeah, two of these words. So you can connect. So mal is something bad. Mal is bad. Area. Very simple. It's not the area. It's ARIA. So it certainly means air, right? It means air. Like suppose you know, aerial creatures and all that. So you know, malaria means bad air. So basically, earlier we did not have the germ theory. We did not know that small microscopic organisms that are invisible to the eye, germs, what we call, these cause diseases. It was discovered by Robert Koch in back in I think 19th or 18th century. Before that, everyone had a basic idea that okay, staying at dirty places causes disease pretty much, but that was a correlation, not a causality. So they didn't know the cause, but they knew that okay, many people who live in diseased bad smelling areas get the disease, right? They didn't even know that mosquitoes carry malaria, let alone know that mosquitoes actually carry something called a plasmodium or a protozoa that causes the disease. But they knew that people who lived in marshy areas had a greater chance of getting malaria. So marshy areas smell, right? Because there is a lot of decay going on and methane is being created, all that, basically just a swamp that is decaying, a dirty water. So mosquitoes breed there, but they didn't know that, but they could connect it pretty well, right? So that's why they named it bad air, because they thought that bad air transmitted this malaria. And even with other diseases, like they didn't know that sneezing would transmit germs, but they saw that when someone sneezed or released air of some kind with their mouth or nose, other persons would get infected. So they pretty much put that equation in. So you see, there is a story behind each word. So you can just connect it, and you'll never forget if you remember the story. It's a permanent solution. It will set itself in your mind. You can never ever forget that. Whenever, even if you forget when the word, you see the word, the story will automatically come. So you can arrive at the conclusion there, right? So these are various ways of getting to a particular word. Now there are now see. Vocabulary is often only told of the ability to new learn ability to learn new words, right? That is not correct. There are two components to vocabulary. Even without learning a new word, you can improve your writing and you can also improve your reading. Like often you read a word that you already know, but that doesn't make sense to you, right? So I'll tell you something. Let me just try this. This is not just ability to learn new words. It's also the ability to use known words in new contexts, right? In new contexts. So let us just try an exercise with all of you. So I'll give you a simple sentence and I want you to give suggest me a better synonym. Okay, so suppose I chose to wear a yellow I chose to wear yellow today. Let's just go with this. This is pretty much fine because I'm choosing to wear yellow today. Very casual, informal choice. But suppose I have to make a graver choice. I chose not to go to the I chose not to grant him, suppose you are a judge and you are granting him a pardon, prisoner a pardon, and chose not to grant him a pardon. Very formal situation. So can you suggest me a better word to replace chose here, right? A better word that you can replace chose with. Like chose is correct, but a more formal word that fits in this context, like better connoted word. So something more formal than choose. Decided is okay, but more formal. Something you already know. I'm not asking you a fantastic word like big word. Very simple word that you already know, but you're not only using it one particular sense. You are not using it in its general meaning. You always use it in a very specific sense. Although it doesn't only mean that. It means a lot more. So okay, I didn't get my answer yet. So I'll just tell you. Very simple. It's elected. Most of you think that elected means elect means something to do with politics. That's not true. In its most general sense, elect simply means choose. Right. You can say that I elected not to attend the meeting. You can, it's pretty much accurate, it's pretty correct. It's the most fitting way you can address a formal situation. So suppose in a passage you get this is written that suppose in a passage you have come across this. He elected to use a pencil instead of a pen. Although not a good way because it's an informal, but suppose a passage gives it, and now you get confused as to what pen and pencil is it about democracy? Is it about a political party? You might assume that the person and the question will also ask you. Questions are often very misleadingly framed. Suppose there is an option. What is the main idea of the passage? And they write, he refers to a president. So you'll see, okay, elected is there. So I think this is correct. So that's never given in the passage. So you'll get confused. Basically, you'll be misled, going for the outlandish solutions that don't make sense, that aren't just there. So basically, that's why you should know how to use a single word in various contexts. Like, let me just try a more very different example. Let's see okay, so you have seen the road, right? Let's say the sides of the highway, the sides of the highway were vacant. Were vacant. Okay, let's say were what can we use? Okay, let's use a different the skyline. Let's say the skyline was broke by the skyline was broken up by tall buildings, right? So broken up is not such a good word. Can you give me a single word that's very perfect fitting, very nice sounding to replace this? A word that you already know. Fragmented is a good word, but not what I'm looking for. Something you know in a different context, something just like elected, something that you use, okay, something that you use only for sentences. You never use it for skyline. You use that word only for writing and everything. You don't use it in for buildings. So can you give me a word? No, not destructive. I'll give you another example. The silence at the library was broken up by the sounds of paper and of pen on paper. Or any sounds of falling pens, let's say falling pens. So it's a very elegant choice if you make this. Can we use this word here? Do you get the sense in which this is being used? Like it's a very beautiful sense if you imagine it in its imagery. Punctuation, what does punctuation do? Punctuation breaks something long into smaller parts. Something continuous that is flowing, it breaks the flow at several intervals. So when in a sentence we use punctuation like commas, full stops, it breaks a flow of speech by punctuating it, right? So we can say that there was continuous silence at the library, but when you're sitting at library, occasionally someone's pen falls down, someone is turning pages of a paper, so you hear that noise. So you can say that the silence was continuous, but on spots it was broken. So similarly, yeah, Anisha, you can ask me a question. Sure. Just send me your question if you have a doubt. You can send me a question on text. So see the skyline, like when there are no buildings in a city, you can see a clear skyline, right, running continuously. But even when there are buildings, you'll see the skyline, but it will be broken by the skyscrapers or the taller buildings. They will break it at several intervals, equal or unequal. So you see how punctuated is being used. Most of you would never have used punctuated outside of punctuating sentences in your life. So you're restricting a word that you already know. So make use of what you know first to its full capacity before going for learning new words. So when you're not doing justice to words that you already know, how can you expect to do justice to new words? First, use up what you already know to its fullest, then go for new words, right? So that is there. This component is something that nobody who teaches vocabulary tells you, right? And if you look at English, there are in any language there are, but English is popular, so that's there. Set has 91 meanings, for example, right? The single word set that has 91 meanings. Now, I'll just try to show you some random meanings out of my head. Even I've not prepared this or something, okay? So don't expect me to list out all 91 meanings. But I'll just try, and you can also help me with some meanings, okay? So let us try to list out some five or six meanings, okay? So we can say that I set the oven. So basically setting some device or mechanical object, I set the oven at 200 degrees, okay? Fair, makes sense. Now, a new meaning of set, another meaning, another way of using set. I set a table for two. Right. That's also a new meaning of using set. Another meaning, the custard has set. You see, in what sense we are using the custard has set, or I can also say the curd or yogurt has set. I can also say that the cement has set, right? So that is a different setting, like setting of some semi-liquid object into a solid form. So consolidation or solidation. So solidification. So that is there. Now group can also be a set, right? This is a set of this is a mathematical set that you know. This is a set of animals, or this is a set of toys, right? That can be there. Then what else can we do? There's many many ways of using it, right? I can go on all day, but that doesn't serve the purpose. You get the point. Point is to get the rule. I'm not here to teach you this specific example of set. Like there are thousands of such examples. How many vocabulary classes will I take? But if I teach you the principle, then you can use it yourself, right? So that is the role of that is my role, to teach you a general rule, not an example. I use examples to teach the rule, to demonstrate a rule. If you my essence is that you learn the rule. How to learn, learning how to learn, not what to learn. That you can do yourself. You are very capable of doing what to learn, right? So you see, words can be used in various contexts. So that is something that's very important. Now, I've already talked about somnambulation and everything. So can anyone tell me what circumambulation means? Like quick testing of how well you are performing. You should use one thing to fuel the other, another thing to fuel the other. So only then can your performance increase. Otherwise, you'll stay constant. So yeah, now suppose you don't know. You know what ambulation means. I have discussed ambulance and everything, going from one place to another, right? So okay. Yeah, two of you got it. Many of you got it correct. Okay. So basically, if you don't know anything, you at least know that circumference is something that is around a circle, right? Around a circle. Sorry. Around a circle. And we also know that circumstance. Circumstance is surrounding factors or surrounding situations, right? Basically, situation around you. So simple, what is common in these two? Circum, right? So I know that circum doesn't mean situation, and circum doesn't mean this, right? So the only word common is around. So I know that circum means something that is around, right? So yeah, right. So now let us just see circumambulation. So circumambulation, I've already told you what ambulation means. So this is something around motion, right? Or so now you get it, right? Around motion. So this basically, if you have seen movies, when people get lost in forest, what they do, they keep moving in circles, right? And when they keep moving in circles, they arrive at the same spot and they think, oh, I walked 5 kilometers and I see the same tree that I left, so now I'm moving in circles. So there's nothing but moving in circles. Very simple. So see, a very complicated sounding word, but how I can make it very simple. Now, talking of complicated words, like just putting this example of don't get scared and run away. Don't leave the meeting just because I'm discussing this word, okay? Don't get scared. That's my point. I'm going to discuss the longest word in English language, which is this. I'll tell you, see, if you can face this word, you can face any word. Like you'll gain confidence. If you can defeat this 45 letter behemoth, then you can defeat anything in English, right? So this is pneumono ultra microscopic silicovolcanoconiosis. Now don't see what most people, why do they get afraid of this word, is you read it wrong. You start to read it, you go like pneum ono ono ultra, then you get confused. You read it mic ro sco. You break it at the wrong places. Don't break it at the wrong places. It's very simple. See, you know these words when you know this ultra is something you have been hearing since a childhood, right? A lot of superhero movies have those ultra thing there everywhere, right? You know what microscopic, you don't even need to break. You know what a microscope is, so don't break it in middle. Silico is okay. Volcano is okay. Conius is okay. Now I'll try to solve it without using any new knowledge. Let me assume I do not know what this means. Okay, so let me try to do this. Okay, thank you for not leaving the meeting by getting scared of this word. So I'll try to make it easy for you. We know pneumonia, right? Pneumonia. And you know pneumatic, right? So this is basically You get where I'm getting at. So basically, pneumonia or pneumatic, this must have something to do with lungs, right? So pneumon is basically something to do with air, lungs, or any diaphragm or membrane, be it a rubber tire diaphragm or the diaphragm in your respiratory system. So something to do with lungs or maybe just right respiration, very simple. I don't need the exact meaning, like just guessing. Ultra is something very high, like very, very ultra basically means very. Like say anything, ultrasound or anything. So very, I know. Microscopic is something too small to be seen, like very small. So maybe add an extra very here, very, very small. So silico is something that has to do with silica. So silica, okay. Volcano, you already know volcano. Corneosis. So if you know this, diseases end with cis or is, right? Many diseases end with ia. Many diseases end with is. Poliomyelitis. Conjunctivitis, right? You see, diseases end with is. So I don't need to know what this means. This basically is some kind of disease. So I get this point. So we got the meaning. That is the meaning of this intimidating pneumono ultra microscopic silico volcano corneosis is just a chronic illness, a simple respiratory disease like bronchitis or asthma that occurs because of very tiny silica particles. Like suppose there is a volcano eruption happening, you live in an area of volcanic activity or even maybe some industrial area that produces similar kind of ash and all that. So this doesn't occur by large particles. Like other diseases are there for large soot particles. This occurs by invisible particles, like very tiny ash and smoke particles that are too small to be seen. That's why microscopic. So this is just describing the kind of particle, microscopic silico volcano. So silicon particles that resemble in size the particles that come from volcanoes and pneumono ultra microscope. In fact, this whole thing is just telling you the particle. Like this is just saying that very small particles. So a disease caused by very small particles, a breathing disease caused, respiratory disease caused by very small particles, right? So very simple. It's nothing to get afraid of with big words. Okay, so that is my point for completing this. Okay, so that is there now. Okay, so what else can we cover? Okay, so my the thing is that you should not get scared of words. Every word has something very interesting to give you. Now let us I'll just give you something Indian to interest you, like some Indian stories behind words. So let's go with shampoo. Can anyone guess how shampoo came to be? Like any guesses? Like give me guesses. Don't give me anything if you already know or you have heard this elsewhere. So suppose, let's see, it seems very weird, right? There is nothing that resembles shampoo in English, right? Like the closest thing I can think of is sham, and sham is something very different. Yeah, okay, that's excellent. So shampoo actually comes from champi. Champi, you know, it's a head massage, right? So British officers who lived in India, they used to get all of these head massages. So that was a complete head massage. It's not just an oil massage. After oiling it, they wanted to wash it away. So wash the oil away, wa so it doesn't get greasy and doesn't look bad. So they used to do shampoo. So over time, champi became something like champu, and then it became shampoo. So that's how it got to English. It got to English from Hindi. So you see, very common words come from Hindi. A lot of words come from Hindi. So when you will explore etymologies, occasionally you'll find something that is very interesting, and you'll think, okay, this thing I knew, this thing I knew, I didn't know that they were related with each other. So now, so there are a lot of very interesting stories behind things. So these are all things that you should always look out for, like something that you can take away. Now there is something called let's begin with this. Okay, there is something called dexterity, right? And there is something called sinister. Now can you please mute yourselves? I please mute yourselves. Okay, otherwise it creates a lot of disturbance in the class. Okay, so there is dexterity. Now, dexterity and sinister. So, language often has biases, right? Language, just like society has biases, these biases enter language over time. So, what happens that people who dominate, they tend to, communities or people who dominate get into all that thing, right? So, they get their biases inside language. So, dexterity means skilled and sinister means evil. Okay, so suppose you don't know this, you need to remember it, right? Yeah. Yeah, Shravya, that's pretty accurate. So, see, the world is dominated by right-handed people. Now, as you have seen by my hand gesturing, I am left-handed, right? So, now people like me are 9 to 11% in this world, minimum 9, maximum 11. So, left-handed people have never been a force as such. So yeah, Dexter was a scientist. So that's a very good way of approaching this question. I was going to tell you, even if you remember that Dexter was a scientist in the cartoons that you watched as a child, you can know that okay, Dexter is someone who is talented, right? And if you know chemistry, there is something called dextrorotatory and levorotatory. So if you know chemistry, it becomes very simple. But again, I've seen chemistry students not being able to connect this for some reason. I don't know why don't they connect this, but they don't. So Dexter is something that means, so what right-handed people basically did, they equated being right-handed with being talented, like such discrimination. You see that. And they didn't just stop there. They actually equated being left-handed, which was called sinister, with being evil. Right? Does like absolute injustice with left-handed people. But that's how language works. So when you study language, you'll find a lot of biases in language. There are biases against women. There are biases against countries. Biases against historically discriminated communities that you'll find in language all the time. Right? Just like let's say Android. So Android basically means a robot that looks like a human. But if you go into its etymology, it should actually be called anthroid, because anthro is what is a human. Anthropology, philanthropy, misanthrope, right? All that thing. You see, it should be anthroid, but it's actually android. So andro means male, right? Andro means male or man, simply man. So this sexist bias of language has always been there, that human basically means man. We always refer to humans as man. We don't refer to as women. So this language has always been biased and discriminatory against, unjust towards women. So you can see all these stories in the origins of words, right? Like android basically should mean a robot that looks like a man, but it's generalized to mean something like a human. Just like you see, right-handed people have generalized dexterity to mean skilled. So yeah, now there are other various other words that reflect these social injustices and biases. If you look at Philistine, so this was a time when Romans were the dominant force, and Romans, despite having all evils in their own civilization, they saw everyone else as uncultured. So people who lived in the traditional areas of Israel and Palestine, that's where we get all Christian and Islam, all religions from, they were seen as even Jews, Christians, everybody was seen by Romans as people who were uncultured. So that's where you get Palestine from. So Philistine basically means someone who is uncultured or does not understand art and refinement, right? Although someone who doesn't understand fine skills or anything like that, like art, culture, those who don't understand. So from Roman biases, basically, that's the point. Even vandalism. Well, you know what vandalism means? Vandalism is nothing but willful destruction of property or anything like public property, or destruction, basically any kind of public destruction, or maybe destruction of property. So any kind of destruction of something good is called vandalism. That's because the Vandals were a Germanic tribe who attacked Rome several times. Like Rome also attacked them, they also attacked Rome. Both were equally aggressive. But since Romans have written history, and most of our language is borrowed from Roman and Greek, most of the important words, there are a lot of Germanic words in English as well. But Romans enjoyed a high social position, a high civilizational position. They wrote a lot. Germanic tribes didn't write many documents. So that's why their writing, it got all these Roman biases. So there are a lot of biases in language that continue to persist all through, right? See, for example, if you see, we call something, when something goes bad, even in idioms you will see it. If things go south, call the police, right? So things go south, literally Europeans being located in the north, they have started to call something going bad as something going south, right? So basically, even if you see, the maps are drawn with the south on downward. It doesn't make sense. Earth doesn't have a direction from outside. We give it a direction. So just because a map has something going south, so okay, south is something bad. So that's what people, or something going down in its position. So that is there. Now there are other, now you learn new usages of word also. Have you ever wondered why something new, something brand new is called mint condition? Right? Can anyone tell me why something new is called mint condition? Like mint, this doesn't have anything to do with the mint plant, as in a breath mint or double mint, nothing like that. See, fresh, but why? That's what I'm asking. No, not no. Okay, that's a good justification you're giving. No, it doesn't have something to do with mint producing a fresh breath. Brownie points for your imagination. Yes, exactly. So coins are made in a mint, right? So in olden days, what used to happen? See, there is a very simple rule in economics, right? That the coin, suppose I have a 1 rupee coin, right? So the 1 rupee coin is always made of a metal of a lesser value, like 0.75 rupee metal. So that when this doesn't happen, economies collapse. Like it happened one time during the rule of Muhammad Shah, I think it was Tughlaq. Yeah, it happened during the time of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, who made coins from gold. So people didn't use the coins. They simply melted the coins, and after melting, the value increased. So that's why the economy collapsed. Useless coins, right? So what happens that when a coin has some kind, coin is not a piece of metal. It's not just a piece of metal. It has some inscription, some symbols or something drawn or written on it, right? So if that writing fades, the value of the coin decreases, right? No one will accept your coin. They will say that it's a piece of metal that you have created that is of the same size as coin. How can I know that it is a coin if it doesn't have the official writing on it, right? So when mint is a place where coins are made, right? So basically, new coins were very good, very important, because new coins in mint condition, they had a high value. And as the inscription, as the things erased from their face, they started to lose value, because now they're just a piece of metal, and a coin always has more value than the metal it is made of. That is the basic rule of having a stable economy. Otherwise, everything goes away. So see, this is the interesting story behind mint condition. That's how we get mint condition, right? So that all is there. Now, we can just think of some other examples. Like, let's say, what else can we discuss? Say, see, there is no fixed plan for going through all this, right? So we can just come up with random things off our head. So let's go with emblazon now. Okay, so emblazon. So emblazon basically means some prominent sign or symbol. Like, if you're a Harry Potter fan, you can say that, okay, I have a shirt that has the Gryffindor or Ravenclaw emblazon, right? Emblazon or something like sigil or a symbol that is there, right? So emblazon is something like that. So if this word has, see, if you learn the etymology of this word, you will at least learn the etymology of 10 other words. Okay. Now see, now I know that M means to do something. Like suppose I have written something, right? I've written make this text bold. Okay. The activity that I'm going to do, like say I'm making this text bold by clicking Control plus B. See, I'm making this text bold. So this activity, this very activity is called emboldening, right? So anything, if you have to convert an some adjective to a verb, you prefix m with that. Okay? So these, you don't need to learn all this. I'm just telling you what is a prefix and suffix. Just ignore the prefix and suffix for most part. Like not always. Sometimes they're very useful. But for now, let's just ignore it. So, and let's just ignore the suffix also. This is just a noun making suffix, so form changing suffix. So basically, we come to blaze, and blaze means fire. Everyone knows blaze means fire, right? Fire or flames, right? So blaze means fire. So can anyone tell me how does fire connect to having a symbol or sign, or most likely an official sign, a very important sign, like maybe a coat of arms or maybe a logo or something like that? So can anyone guess what's the relation between a fire? How do we make this transition? Like leave it to up your leave it to your imagination. Just give me creative answers, even if they're outlandish. You don't need to worry. Okay, give me an answer so I can proceed. Like quickly, just two or three things you can think off your head. Okay, some more. Okay, that's interesting. Torch bearer, interesting. Emblem comes from there. Excellent deduction, excellent observation rather. Emblem comes from there, so those things are related. So just quickly, okay, so I'll just tell you. See, I'll just use some annotation tools and I'll do some drawing here, okay, to explain you how this thing works. So in ancient times, we didn't have printing, right? That is something you know. We didn't have printing in ancient times. So what people used to do, they used to take a iron rod. Suppose this is my iron rod. I take this iron rod and suppose I have to create a logo. Say my logo is a spiral. This is my brand. Okay, let's say my brand name is B. So I create a B by twisting the iron rod. Then I heat it over coals or maybe whatever source of fire I have. So I heat it. Now this thing turns red hot, right? It starts emitting light and it gets really hot, like 1200 degrees or something like that. So I heat it. And then what I do, I own cattle, right? I own horses. I own little goats, maybe. Goats are not that important. Horses or cows, I own horses or cows. So I just take this brand and hit it on all my cows so that they know, any they don't get mixed up. Like tomorrow, if someone tries to steal my cow, I can show that, okay, this has this it will create a permanent burn mark, right? It will be burned onto its flesh and that thing doesn't go away. So I can make sure that nobody will steal my cows, और दे विल नॉट गेट इंटरमिक्स विद इंफेरियर वेराइटी काउज और एक्सचेंज विद अ सिमिलर लुकिंग इंफेरियर वेराइटी काउ और हॉर्स, मे बी मोर इम्पोर्टेंट फॉर हॉर्सेज सिंस हॉर्स ब्रीड इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. सो इट विल नॉट बी माई थोरोब्रेड हॉर्स विल नॉट बी रिप्लेस बाई पुअर क्वालिटी हॉर्स, राइट. सो यू सी हाउ दिस इज कॉल्ड कैटल ब्रांडिंग और हॉर्स ब्रांडिंग, एनिमल ब्रांडिंग प्रैक्टिस, राइट. सो दिस इज हाउ वी गेट द वर्ड ब्रांड फॉर. सो एवरी थिंग फ्रॉम माइक्रोसॉफ्ट टू गुची वर्साची और से ज्यादा और एनी एनी ब्रांड्स दैट वी हैव टुडे, फिलिप्स और एनीथिंग, ऑल दैट ब्रांड, दैट वर्ड ब्रांड कम्स फ्रॉम दिस प्रैक्टिस ऑफ बर्निंग हॉट आयरन रॉड्स ऑन टू थिंग. एंड दिस वॉज नॉट फॉर एनिमल्स, इट वॉज ऑल्सो फॉर, सपोज आई हैव अ कंसाइनमेंट ऑफ एप्पल्स एंड आई से दैट माई एप्पल्स आर द बेस्ट. So they, that because people know that my apples are the best, and once they taste it, they buy it only from me. I imprint my this red hot iron onto a box. I put some wax there or shellac there, and I burn the wax, so this mark gets created permanently. Or I just burn it on the box itself. So now this is how we get brand from. So you get where I'm getting at with this. A blaze is what we get fire from. So you now you know how brand comes. It's literally called an iron brand or something like that. So emblem comes from there, right? So a lot of words come from there. Like there are many other words, but since I'm now in a hurry, so I'm not able to cover all of them. But just do explore this etymology. You'll get that all words are connected. There are like 50 words that are connected with each other from this process of branding, right? So many words are there like that. So it's pretty interesting domain out there with brand and blaze. Now let me just cover two more, two very interesting words, like two most interesting etymologies that I know. So these are just examples. I'm not saying these examples will come in cat. They might, like they might. I can't assure that they won't come either. But my point is that you learn methods, and just for your simplicity's sake, you don't need a dictionary to learn etymology. Like don't get a paper dictionary. Cat is an even cat preparation should be smart and fast. Simply go with Google. Don't get normal Lewis or anything. Go with Google. Look up a word that you come across. It can either be from a cat mock you are solving, a passage you are reading, or any casual book or novel that you are reading. If you get a word, look it up on Google. See, now what happens often when you try to look up a word on Google, suppose you want it to define Avenger, right? Now, what happens if you just simply Google Avenger? What happens is that you will not get the dictionary entry as the first result. You will instead get something like this: Avengers 2008 film. This will be the first result, and then everything else will be just squeeze, right? When you want a dictionary entry for the word, there is a very simple hack. Just use this keyword define and define and just write Avengers, or you can simply define Avengers, sorry, or you can write Avengers. You'll get the exact meaning of the word. So it's a very fast way of Googling. Googling is the best way to build your vocabulary. Something very unconventional, but it works certainly better sitting in a paper book. Google words. If you have your phone right now, right? If you have your phone right now, what you can do? Google. There is something in Google. There is a dictionary entry there, and at the bottom there is an option translations and more definitions. If you click on that, at the very bottom there's something called origin. And if you don't find that origin thing, then it might be because it's Google search is a bit short, so you might not get the full picture. So there are two resources: Wiktionary and online etymology, right? So you can refer to these. They have very elaborate stories behind each word, right? So just telling you the method to learn new words, so you can use them to your benefit, right? So that is there. Now, what else? So there are pretty interesting observations and other, like suppose, yeah, this is okay. Lagging. Can you hear me? Hello. Lag, I guess. Net problem. Hello. Am I audible? Drop me a text if you can hear and see me. Can see me properly? What issues are there? Drop me a text if you can hear me. ओके
ओके
या कैन यू हियर कैन यू अनम्यूट योर कैन आई एम ऑडिबल Can you drop if you can see me? Yeah, great. Thank you. So I hope you didn't miss anything. So I was just saying that go to Google. Google is a very fast way of stuff. Go to Google, look up a dictionary entry, and always use this keyword define before anything that you suppose you want to look up cat. You literally don't know what cat means. Maybe you are very new to English. So if you look up cat, most of the results will be about cat exam, just because they are localized. Google localizes search results. So in India, you might not get that cat. So you can just use the word define to make it unambiguous, and just go to translations and more definitions. Click on that option. It's usually hidden, and once you're there, just look up to the origin. And once you're at the origin, you just look up to the you can find the answer. And if you are not satisfied with the story, just go to Wiktionary or online etymology to get a complete picture of that thing. Okay, so that is there. Now let me just give you two very interesting etymologies that we can cover. So there is something called crimson, right? And there is something called vermilion. Now these both are pigments. These both are reddish pigments, right? One is reddish orange, one is light red, right? So these are reddish pigments. So these both have etymology in the same thing, right? So let me just, instead of going this way, let me show you how it came. So okay, so crimson and vermilion, right? So these both have come from two different languages, but essentially the same process. Okay, so basically, okay, let me just okay, I'll just show you here. So crimson comes from Sanskrit, and vermilion comes from Greek, right? So but both have the same rooted in the same etymology. So okay, if you know this, you know what vermicelli is. Vermicelli is nothing but what we call in India as sevai, right? Sevai is vermicelli essentially. So vermicelli is essentially a pasta that looks like worms, right? Or even if you have heard vermi in other contexts, like that's just because appendix looks like a worm. I think it's like a worm, vermiform. So shaped like a worm, shaped like a worm. Okay. So now you know that vermi literally means worm in Greek, right? Yeah, vermicompost. Yeah, excellent. Yeah, great. Vermicompost, obviously. So vermi is something that means worm in Greek. That's where we literally worm. Simple, you get the sound, right? So now can you tell me how did we get these red pigments from something talking of worms? And if crimson, let me tell you, if you have heard this, I don't know how many of you have heard this. In Hindi, even in Hindi, if you go to traditional doctors, they call worms as creamy, like those tapeworms that you get in your intestines, those are called creamy, right? So if you can tell me how did we arrive at red, like okay, I don't expect you to tell me, it's very strange, but even today, even in the 21st century, because it's so cheap, any red food coloring that's cost effective, like not expensive red food coloring, but any I mean fairly moderate priced red food coloring is made by red food coloring. In this red food coloring, okay, crushing and grinding dried insects. Okay, there are a particular kind of insects whose scales they're killed. They're all insects are killed, they're ground up to a powder, and that powder is, creates red. It's a pigment called cochineal. If you don't believe that you have eaten red insects in your life, you can just look this up, you'll know where I'm getting at. So, basically, this was the process. This process has been done in ancient India. This was done in Greece. So basically, there was an interaction between these two civilizations. So we don't know which who created it first, but whatever be the case, both these countries were grinding insects and creating these pigments. They didn't have a good source for creating. So people used to grind insects and create. So this is the origin of crimson and vermilion. How we get those to these two. Pretty interesting stuff if you really. Delve into all that, right? So that is there. Now, okay. Now there are word. Now coming to hard word roots, like just approach to tell you quickly learning things. So this is one of the most popular, most basic word roots that's there. Gen means to produce or birth. Okay, to create, maybe create new life or create anything new, just anything new. So we get a whole class of words in every language, every single language from this gen. Right, say we just take Hindi and English both, right? And we get a lot of words in Hindi and English from this. So let me first cover English, then we can get to Hindi. We get genesis, generation, right? Then we get genus in biology, genus, and then we get genitals, we get genitalia, genitals, all that. Then we get a lot of words we get from here. Maybe a generation in both senses, as in the generation gap generation, and in the generation, like generation of something, creation of something, right? So there is a lot of like progeny, progenitor, or a lot. Like this list can just go on and on and on and on. You just open a dictionary that starts with gen and you can see the whole section, right? And in Hindi, we get a lot of words from gen as well. We get jan, we get janak, janni, a word for mother. We get a word for genitalia as well. And we have all these words in Hindi and Sanskrit from gen, right? So basically, this is the point. So if you learn one particular root word, you can learn n number of words that branch off from it, right? And then the basic thing to remember is that any word has the following structure. So any word, any word, literally any word in the word. So it has, let's say, m prefixes, okay? One root, maybe one or many root words. And then, okay, let me just write as n root words and p sub can range from, sorry, m and p can be any, take any value from to maybe anything, zero to anything basically. So there's a practical limit, like you get anything with more than four suffixes or something like that. Okay, so that is like, say, let's take this word. This is an actual word. Anti-disestablishmentarianism. Basically, it means something, basically nothing, but this means pro-establishment ideology, where you support the authority. Basically, something like conservatism, okay, right-wing politics. Basically, this means right-wing politics. So if you try to break this word, how many prefixes do we have? We have anti, a prefix. We have dis as a prefix. And then if you treat establishment as a whole word, although you shouldn't, so let's take establish as a whole word. Like establish can also be broken down, but today it has become a solid word. So let's keep it at that. And then let's move to suffixes. So suffixes, you have meant, right? Then you have, we come all the way here, and Aryan, and again, we have ism. So you see, we have, basically we have two prefixes, one root word, and three suffixes, right? Now this can also be split to give more things, but basically this is the structure. So sometimes there can be no prefix, only one suffix. Sometimes there is no suffix, only one or two prefixes. Sometimes just the word root itself, nothing else, like red, nothing, no prefix, no suffix. Red, simple, red or blue. This is basically just break it with this and always identify the root word first. Don't try to, if it's very easy, identify the suffix and prefix first so you can go to the root word, right? That is also a good approach, but just depends on the situation. Use your discretion wisely, like use your wits there. So that is there. Now let us see some, so you get the point, right? This is how it works. Now let us go into some other words as well. Suppose you don't know, see, you know aura, right? Aura is something that's like a glow, right? Now what you would rather not know is, you have always wondered that why gold is represented as AU, right? That's because obviously we know gold is something that shines, right? It appears lustrous and shiny. So what it was called aurum in Latin, right? So aurum literally means something that glows. So gold has this aura. If you have seen a lot of gold at one place, it literally shines, right? It seems that it is giving out light. So that's why now when someone has a face that is very radiant, we call, okay, he has an aura on his face, right? Aura, that is also associated with divine figures. You see all those light rays emanating from divine figures in pictures and representations. So that is where we get aura from. Now, there is also one advantage of learning. There are certain words, this is not always the case, and sometimes you'll get terribly confused. But for some words, it applies that if you see, all these words have a similar meaning, and they all start with gl, G-L. See, glow, glitter, glint, gloss, glimmer, gleam, all these words have a similar meaning. I mean, suppose glass also, like if you see it that way, it's shiny, something that is shiny or lustrous. So a lot of words like that, right? So even glitter is there, gloss, so a lot of words like this. So you can group words together and remember them as one, because you'll never be asked to Find the exact meaning of a word. You will only be asked to approximate a word, right? Just approximate something and you will know. So sometimes words contain roots that you don't realize. Now you all know that buy and die stand for, they stand two, basically. Buy and die stand for two, right? But you have you ever wondered why dilemma is called dilemma? Dilemma is when you are not able to make a decision. So originally dilemma meant two difficult choices. So dilemma. If you have read maths in class 9, there was something I remember called Euclid's division lemma, right? So lemma is like a theory or principle, something that we something like an axiom, right? Something between an axiom and theory. I remember it was there. So basically dilemma means two choices or two propositions that is very hard to choose between, right? Two procedures that you find very hard to choose between. So often there are words of, I'm not sure if this is correct, but just a good way to remember, bias is something that depends on by, right? Two. So there are two poles of choices that you can choose between, right? So that is there. Now, you get the point, right? So there, suppose you have to guess the meaning of a word, and there is a there is some something given that you don't know. Let's say insulation. What does insulation mean? And now I, okay, the four options will never be very similar. Like insulation will be a kind of animal, or insulation would be an economic activity, or a cooking process, or exposure to sunlight, say. So see, I don't know what exactly insulation means. I don't need to know, rather. I just know that sol is the Latin or Greek word for sun, right? Because I know solar is there. Solar is something everyone knows, right? Solar is something everyone knows. You know solstice, something related to the sun. There are many other words like that you know. So basically, I know at least solar everyone knows. So I know that, okay, I don't know what exactly insulation means, but I know it is something related to sun. So I just need sun. So no other option will have sun. Only this option will have. So you can mark it pretty much easily, like solstice also. Yeah. So you can just mark it pretty easy. So you get the philosophy, what I'm trying to say here. CAT will never ask you exact meanings. It will give you the exact meaning in the option. You only need to distinguish it from three. Similar with maths. If you can approximate something close enough to differentiate, eliminate other three options, you don't need to find the fourth option exactly. Okay, it looks fair enough far. It is in my range. Other three are not. I'll get this answer. So this is a general way of solving, questions. So, you see, that is how, now that I've told you the principles, let me warn you of how things can go wrong. If two words sound, they needn't be the same. Like, equus means horse, but say words like, this doesn't mean that words like equitable or equal or equanimous, right? Or equanimity, they don't come from horse. This is not the correct etymology, right? One thing you can see is that, okay, this has a W. But even if it doesn't, sometimes words have, because what happens, I'll tell you. See, suppose this is a, two words are coming from their origins, right? Suppose this is the origin of one word, this is the origin of another word. Now, this word is coming through another, suppose it's coming through a root. It's gone to word number two. Now, this is its second form. And this word has gone to its second form here. And then what happens after some time, this word evolves to a third form. And maybe this word will pass through a third form and arrive at its final form. But sometimes what will happen, that is third form will happen just by sheer coincidence to be the same word as this, right? To be the exact same word as this. So what happens that two words converge here and you get the mistaken notion that these two words are related, but there is no connection between these two words, right? That's the difference between homologous and analogous. If you have read in biology, what happens? Birds also have wings. Right, birds also have wings, and bats also have wings, right? But if you know, they are analogous organs. Both are used for flying, but birds' wings are made of feathers, while bat wings are just a membrane of skin stretched between arms. So bat wings are basically just its arms which are having some skin there, while birds' wings are proper feathers like things, right? So they don't have the same origin. Birds have evolved with a different ancestor, and bats have evolved with a different ancestor. So what I'm getting at is, I'll tell you an example of how if I've told you a method, I should also tell you where that method fails. So suppose I'm telling you this method of root words, right? So let me try this bacillus. Let me try something like bacillus, maybe radius. Okay, so, or maybe try something like anything that ends with us. Let me try hippopotamus. Okay, one simple exercise. I want you to give me plurals of these words. Just give me plurals of these words. Just give me the plural of radius, because most of you are from science background, so you know what a plural of radius is called. Like it's mentioned in the question, two circle of something, itna centimeter, itna centimeter. Yeah, it's called radii, right? And if you have read bacillus, it's called bacilli in biology, right? And if you have read hippopotamus, it's called hippopotami. Simple, very simple. At least one of this you would have come across in your life. So now the first thing, the first problem, just know radii. You think that the rule is to you might sometimes not all of you, sometimes some people might do this mistake, right? But you need to observe that it's not simply adding double I. Be careful. What you are doing, one I was already there, right? This I was already there. That's part of the spelling. You're actually replacing an us, let me mark it, an us by a double I, right? That's what you're essentially doing. So I'm making this substitution. So it's not double I, it's simply just a single I. So let me just remove this, right? You get what I'm saying, right? So it's a single I substitution because this I was already there. So don't make that mistake. So, okay, now I observe the same pattern across three words. So I fairly have got that us is some suffix, and it's actually a Latin suffix. If you have seen, names of Romans are always ending in us. Asterix the Gaul is a comic series that makes a lot of fun of this fact. So anyways, you know that Augustus, Julius, Maximus, Brutus, all that, us is everywhere. So basically Romans ended everything, every noun, many nouns with us. With us, and then plurals became I. So I've made these substitutions here. Now I'll give you one question so I can ascertain if you have understood this. Okay, let me just give you one question to solve. So my question is, I want you to make a plural word of this. Tell me the plural of this. Okay, very quickly. What is the plural of octopus? Quick. So as expected, all of you are answering this. Now this is absolutely wrong. It's not octopi. Now I'll tell you why. And this is not something illogical. This is not like I'm talking of an exception that this is an exception. Remember it. It's not a know it or not matter. It's perfectly logical. I'll explain what is the logic behind this. So see, I know bacillus. I know bacillus. See, I'm breaking it here. Why? Because if you have seen bacteria, there are four kinds of bacteria, right? And one, the most popular kind that is shown in all textbooks and TV and everywhere is that rod cylinder shaped bacteria, right? Cylinder or tubular bacteria. So basically, bacillum or maybe just bacillum just meant rod, right? So Latin has this something called case. So that don't worry about this arm and all, right? So it's just case changing. English doesn't have a case. Sanskrit and other languages have case. So it's a problem that English speakers don't recognize. So basically, bacillum means rod. Here, bacil basically just the root bacil meant means something. It means something. Similarly, here hippopotam actually has two words, hippo and potam, but it means something. Hippo means horse, potam means water or river. So hippo is a horse of the river. So hippopotam also makes sense. That's why its suffix makes sense. Can you break this? So now what mistake you are making? You are breaking octopus as octop us. Now tell me if you are doing this, what does octop means? I told you that bacil means rod. I told you that hippopotam means horse of the river. Do you know anything that octop? Have you ever heard this word in your life, even in Latin or Greek? Octop. Can you find it in any other word as a root word? Like yes or no? Do you know octop, what it means? Hey, Rachel, that's correct, right? You are going on the right track. So octop is not correct. Octop is not the, yeah, Omkar has got it correct. Very true. See, the problem is it's not octopus, it's octopus. So what you are trying to do is with us, right? But this pus is not a suffix. It is the second root word, in fact, right? So if you see, is the prefix, is the, this is the root word. Like it is at least one root word. So this is not correct. I'll just mark it. This is wrong. It is not octopus. It's octopus. So you have to break it at the right place. So see, it was perfectly logical. It's not an exception. It's just that you got it. You started following a trend, and then you got conditioned to think in that way. Okay. So now everyone knows what octo means, right? You have known this. Unlike octop, you know what octo means, right? Can anyone tell me what octo means, right? It's, I know everyone knows, but tell me just in case. Like, what does October? Oh, 8, right. It's like, see, October, right. Now, this opens a different can of worms, which I'll treat later. Why does October is the 10th month instead of being the 8th month? That has a big, big explanation. Like, that is also very interesting, but the class time is limited. So, but octagon, you know, right? Octagon, 8 sides, है ना? You know, all learned this in class 5 or class 4, grade 4, I think, whatever. So, octobase basically means 8. So, 8 feet, 8 legs you can call, or you can call 8 arms, whatever you call it. Basically, octobase, 8 feet, 8 appendages. So, this, now you get it. Why? So, what should be the plural? Now, can anyone correct yourself? Just give me the plural. So, you know, it's not us. The us is not at fault. It's pus. So, now can anyone tell me the correct plural of octopus? Oh, sorry. Hello, hello. Am I audible now? Audible? Hello? Yeah. Okay. If you missed any part, you can repeat. Omkar got it correct again. So see, basically, I'll just repeat in case you were not able to hear me. What I was saying is, basically, octop is not a valid root. Octo is a valid root. 8 feet, basically, 8 appendages of any organism with 8 appendages. So here, this is very simple, very simple, very simple. I just tell you. You know a rule, simple rule in modern English. You don't need to go in Latin. How do you pluralize bus, or how do you pluralize box? Words that end in an S sound. With box, you can visualize as box, but okay. Matlab, anything that ends with an S sound, how do you make a plural? Like, say, if I something doesn't end with S, I can simply make snake as snakes, right? So, but exactly, Shravya, correct. Okay, so see, bus becomes buses, very simple. Yeah, exactly, Rachel. Yeah, so we append an ES after that, so box becomes boxes. So, very simple. This octopus is a mod like treated as modern English, right? Just treated as octopuses, very simple. So, you see, be very careful with etymology, it will always make sense if you know the context. And exceptions can be explained. It's not like you have to just mug up the exceptions and rote it. It's fine. You can study and everything will make sense after a point of time. But the thing is, you have to delve deep enough for things to make sense. Although this is not related to vocabulary, but just talking of plurals, there are some other things that I wish to cover just in case. So, right. Can anyone tell me the plural of? I'll just give you some words. I want you to make their plurals. Okay. Just give me plurals of all these words that I'm giving. Okay, very quickly. Can you tell me? Okay, one more. Come on. So, yeah. Just give me the plural of Governor General very quickly. Very quickly, just to tell you why you should not remember examples, but you should remember rules. And more than in rules, you should remember logic, the original logic. That is more important than rules. When examples fail, rules work, and when rules fail, logic works. So this is not correct, right? This is correct because see, this is the qualifier, kind of like an adjective. This is the main noun that is being talked. This is the core word. So you see, sister-in-laws doesn't make sense, right? Sisters-in-law, if you have to talk of several sisters of your spouse, your husband or wife, several sisters of your wife, so you're not calling sister-in-laws, right? Sisters-in-law, they're basically sisters. In-law is a qualifier, right? So coat of arms, it's basically a coat, like coats of arms, like makes sense. But you don't do the thing same thing here. Just because I've told you, don't make the same mistake here. Like, you suppose I've given you this. Now what you don't make it this, or you don't make it this, because here the qualifier is prefixed. Here the qualifiers were suffixed. If you have seen here, sorry, here the qualifiers were suffixed. Here the qualifiers are prefixed. So here you can simply attach air vice marshals, right? But here you cannot attach s. Here you have to attach s here. So fail. But logic never fail, be it math or be it English, right? So logic will never fail you. So this is logic work. So okay, so that was, and a few more examples before we, very very simple example. Suppose masquerade, you don't know what this means. I suppose I don't know what masquerade means, but the closest thing that I can get by hearing is something related to mask, right? Or although this is not the correct etymology, but it works, right? So it works, it's fine. So I can say it's related to something like, or I know that aid is something like cavalcade, or words that typically end in aid. So aid typically talks of some event, right? So mask, some mask event. So basically, masquerade is nothing but a masquerade is a party where everyone wears masks, right? Yeah. people wear masks to hide their identity. If you have seen the movie Van Helsing, that features a masquerade ball, wears a mask. So how so see when you're in trouble, you can just instead of giving up or instead of speculating, make logical speculation. At least whenever you're speculating, make informed guesses, make good conjectures, and you can distinguish options. The options will not be given with such nature that you'll not be able to them. And then let me just think of some other words. What else can we cover? Now relevant words. Talking of masks, anyone knows why coronavirus is called the just in case. I know coronavirus is not a word that you will need to remember. Like, it has been driven in our heads. Or why quarantine is called quarantine. Just relevant words currently. So coronavirus, basically, if you have looked at it, it's a spiky ball, right? It's shown as a spiky ball. So that peptide proteins that emanate from it, like spikes all through, those spikes make it resemble. So corona basically means a crown, right? Corona crown, very similar sounding. And even the sun has something called a corona. So sun has this crown-like diamond ring that is only visible in the solar. So you cannot see it at any time because it's so too bright. It's only visible in no, that's not correct. But that's that you got right. But it's not that thing. So corona basically means crown. Quarantine. I'll tell you why quarantine is called quarantine. So basically, there is something you at least you know this, right? Anything with say quad or quart or anything on the similar lines, this means four, right? It's something to do with four. So basically, here quarantine actually means 40 days, right? So this was rooted in a practice where this the ancient people knew some things about diseases, right? They didn't know the germ theory, but when they knew that when people come from new countries, they bring diseases. So they had a rule in Italy at ports, right? Italy being a very important maritime civilization, Italy had any ship coming from a new country should wait 40 days, 40, 40 days for before entering the city. Like you will stay docked at the port, but no one will disboard from the ship. Everyone will stay on the ship for 40 days. So what used to happen if anyone had a disease? Either they die or they recover. So either way, by dying or by recovery, the pathogen is neutralized, right? So either your immune system kills the bacteria or virus, or it kills you and it dies because you are dead. So after that, people were allowed. So this 40-day period was taken from the Arabs, and this actually proved a great approximation because most diseases have a period less than 40 days, and it's very close to the mark. It doesn't waste your time also. Like it's not like 100 days or 1,000 days. Very accurate. So that's a very interesting story behind any terminology that you don't like. That's totally fantastic or something like that, right? So some etymologies are boring, but even if you read a novel, right? Harry Potter has some pretty interesting etymologies, like why its characters are named so. So Harry Potter has a lot of interesting etymologies, right? So you can check that as well. And what else can we cover? So that's there. And okay, a few more if I can think of something. Okay, a few other words. Okay, so there is a very popular joke in English that we don't have a word for day after tomorrow, right? We don't have a word for day after tomorrow. We have to say this whole thing all the time. But we have a particular word. We have something called demonstration. Right. So defenestration means a very specific act. It means the act of just a second. Defenestration is the act of throwing something out of the window. So very funny in this regard that it doesn't have some words are very specific, some words are very general. Right. But if you read the etymology, such this word has a pretty interesting history as well. So make sure you check out what the history of this word is. And I think it's there on Wiktionary, so you can check. So like there are words, so these words become insurmountable if you do not think of something to help you crack it. Now I'll just give you another example of how I make things memorable. So this will not only help you with vocabulary, this can also help you with general knowledge. So general knowledge, you have to remember random words, right? Suppose you are preparing for an example, for an exam like maybe ZAT or maybe IAFT, right? Just other non-CAT exams. So they often have a section on GK, and one of the questions that come each year is river. Geography questions are often in GK. River names is something you will be expected to remember. So suppose you have to suppose can anyone tell me which is the most important river in Say you have to do a river matching, or say just give me four options are given. You have to match this river in Thailand, Vietnam, Indonesia. So not Indonesia, sorry, Thailand, Vietnam, Cambodia. Suppose you have this. So you have to match a river with these countries. So which is the most important river in these places, if you can tell me, if anyone knows. Okay, so I'll just tell you the name, but if I tell you this random fact, you'll forget it after some time, right? So that's what happens when you learn from GK book. You forget things after a point of time. But if you go with etymology, you'll not forget it. So right now, I'm going to tell you this thing which most of you, assuming that you're not answering, do not know. But you'll know now, and you won't forget it either. So see, the river is called Mekong. Okay, Mekong is a very huge freshwater river that flows in Southeast Asia. All these countries derive most of their fresh water from this river. So sorry, Mekong, right? So Mekong is a very important river. Now you have to remember this name, and it's not in your language, so you find it difficult to remember. So the story behind this is very interesting. What happened that these places basically were colonized by South Indian kingdoms, had a lot of good navies, right? They used to explore further south. They used to send expeditions to Indian Oceans. So the Cholas and Pandyas, all these kingdoms were exploring these places. Like they discovered a lot of places like Malaysia, Indonesia. They went there and colonized, kind of colonized them. So when the South Indian civilizations, the kings who were across this gigantic river in Southeast Asia, they okay. Suppose you have come across a new river, and you have to name it. Like, what will you do? You do not know the land who live there. Like, you know your language, and you don't know what the river is. So what you will do? You name it after something you already know, right? Something already known. So what is one river that every Indian knows? Like, every Indian knows one part. The most generic name that you can think. Like, if I see what the Britishers did when they went to America, they named places after their old cities. So it's like New York. New French went, they named it after New Orleans. So Dutch went New Amsterdam. British went New Jersey. So Jersey is a town in Britain, they named it New Jersey. So Ganga is something they knew. And in India, we refer to rivers as mother, right? So everyone has heard this term, that we never call Ganga Ganga, we call it Ma Ganga, right? So this simple, very simple way of remembering it. What actually happened, this thing in the local dialect, it became Ma, it turned to Ma Gong. Like, let me just remove this A for confusion. So this basically became Ma Gong. Ganga became Gong, and then sounds like, sounds th that kind of dialect, right? Gong sounds like that kind of dialect. So then it became Ma Gong, and simply it became Mekong over time, right? So very simple fact that Mekong was named after Ma Ganga. You'll never in your entire life. Like, it's pretty weird. Like, such stories are often very weird. Like, who would have thought that this was the case? So this is, can over time. So that is there. And what else can we cover? Okay, so let us cover some twilight. Suppose you don't know what twilight means, right? But you know that twi means two, right? You know twi means two. Like, how do you know this? You know this from twice, right? Or you know this from twin, or you know this from like many other words, right? So twin and twice are two. So twilight should technique should you should think that twilight means two light, right? But doesn't make sense, right? So what happens often, there is a confusion between n learning etymologies. There is always a confusion. I tell you why. You often get confused between this deka and deci, right? Decimeter, decameter, which is 1/10, which is 10. And this is a classic question in English exams. Like, this is a very classic question, biannual and biannual. Like, even I confuse it all the time. Like, what does biennial mean? What does biannual mean? Okay. So this is something where you should distinguish. Like, there is not much help. You have to remember it. Right? So biennial and biennial is something that is very important. One is biennial. I think biennial is something that occurs every, something that occurs twice each year. So basically, this occurs every, if you find it difficult to remember, this occurs every 24 months. This occurs every 6 months, right? Often n and 1/n, there's a lot of confusion. So deca-deci. So basically, sometimes things are flexible. So twi basically meant half. It came to mean 1/2 rather than two, right? So voice is breaking. Okay, just a second. Net issues, I guess. Can you hear me now? Hello? Audio. or drop me a text. It came like it's making too light, it's making half light. Makes more sense, right? Because light is something we see at dusk and dawn when night and day meet. So this is the half light, like light where you cannot see properly, but there is certainly not dark, right? Morning and evening, dusk and dawn. So that is how we get twilight. So sometimes there's a little bit of corruptions and changes are there. So you have to take them into account. But rest assured, you will gone through this. Another very interesting technology is decimate. Now, decimate, what we call annihilation or what we call obliteration, right? Very unrelenting, destruction. So basically, decimate means this. It means total. It means obliteration, basically. So this is that. Now, if you see the etymology of decimate, this comes from the root word deci. Deci means one by. Deca means 10, but deci. I typically the smaller one. So anywhere, like again, you see, this is actually rooted in sexist practices. In any language, even in Hindi, I is used for female. Have you noticed that? I is any language, I or even a. Might be from language, but I is and words ending I, like female form is made by adding. Sorry, I this happens in Hindi, but in English, this A is not there, but I is there everywhere. I is used for females, so there is something is small, you can add there, right? So this is making a diminutive thing here. So, this is there. So, this is again a very sexist thing of okay, voice is breaking. Sorry, audible now. Yeah, just a second. Yeah, hello. Yeah, I'm audible. Yeah. Okay, so desi means I. So basically, I is used to denote something small, right? Something small. So desi and deca. So desi means 1 by 10. So decimate was a very interesting history. Wars were waged. Often when you won the war, you didn't kill all soldiers, right? After killing some soldiers, you basically win the war, and rest are prisoners of war. So even people, brutal people, don't want to kill everyone, like bloodshed. Everyone wants to avoid bloodshed. So what the Romans and Greeks, they had a practice where they took each regiment and killed 1/10 of soldiers of each regiment. Now you might think, if they, why is it just to drop their morale and just make them surrender? Just they kill 1/10 of the people. They don't kill everyone, so that they don't regroup. They get all very sad and heartbroken to see people being killed in front of them, even though it's 1/10. And this helps them not kill so many people and have them as slaves or something else instead, and make sure that these slaves don't revolt. So basically, it's why it's called total destruction, is because it totally destroys. It doesn't totally destroy the army, but it totally destroys the morale of the troops, right? Of the opponents that you have captured. So sometimes things are, you have to dig more than the surface. If you just dig on the surface, that okay. If you do just look at the surface, it's just 1/10. You see why it's called total destruction, right? It shouldn't be total destruction. It's like partial destruction, but it has a more of a figurative sense, more of a figurative etymology there. To conquer the whole troop, right? So that was the punishment that was given. It was called decimation, and this decimation came to mean this here, right? So there is logic there, and there are a couple others that I could discuss if you have the time. So okay, if you just look at some other words, right? Just you can basically, there is something called a cascade method. So what you can do, you can just start from one word and then go from just start from one word. Let's take a word. So can you just suggest a word? So I can start there, like serve it as a starting point. That's why I'm teaching you how to learn, right? I might not know the etymology of the word you give me. Just inbox me a random word, no, like random word. So I can start from there, right? So anything? Ornithology, okay, ornithology. From know that logos means study, right? And ornitho, okay, this was taken from a student, right? It was not my creation. I just showed, just to show you how you can be spontaneous. I'm doing this experiment. So ornitho, it means birds, basically, right? Ornithology is the study, nothing but the study of birds. So now see, I've learned one word today. Now I'll just not stop here. I'll try to go further. Now what I'll do, I'll just take this logos and learn every single word that comes from this. I don't need to learn every single word. After just 5 or 6 words, when you realize the pattern, ecology, study of cancer, then there is suppose anything like ichthyology, the study of fishes, right? Ichthyology. I'll go to paleontology. Paleontology is the study of fossils, right? Now, as soon as I come at one particular place, I think I can realize something. Okay, suppose paleontology. Now, you don't continue doing this forever. You don't need to remember every single logy in this earth. Okay, once I come to paleontology, what I do? I digress. Now, I don't go with the. I now go with the prefix, or I go to the first part of the word. So I go with paleonto. Okay, paleonto. So I now go with paleo plus. Suppose it's like this. So I go with paleo now. Okay. So paleo, I now go with paleolithic. So that's if you have come across, there are many food fads nowadays, right? Keto diet, paleo diet. So I get into paleo diet, which is basically a pseudo scientific thing, but it says that eat like a caveman and you'll be healthy and you'll lose weight. Like cavemen weren't fat, so you will also not be fat. So basically, I don't know what the science is, but this is how you get to paleo. So basically, if I go with paleolithic, suppose, and then I start with lith. So I start alkali metals. Typically, lithium was something that sunk like a stone, so it was seen as a pebble or stone in water, right? So that was an exception because of its energy of hydration. I think it behaves in an exceptional way. So that's why we get the element lithium from. Then we get of printing that comes basically from a reference to stone. Right now, if I talk of stones, I have another word for stone, which is calcul. From because we used to count with stones or pebbles, we got calculation from there, calculator and calculations from there, and that also became the basis of calculus, right? Because we are dividing things into small bits. So you see, we started counting with, so we started with logos, we ended with calculus. We did not stop here. We can just go on. So basically, whenever you start with a word, just researching, you'll end up with maybe hundreds of words in that sequence. So you can go on a spree and just read and read and read and read and more and more, more and more, more and more. So basically, this is what is what I call the cascade method. So you can go. So if you go with ornitho, you can learn a lot of dinosaur etymologies here. Like dinosaurs were basically of two kinds. There were ornithischians and saurischians, I think. I don't remember clearly. These were bird-like dinosaurs and lizard-like dinosaurs. Now, from here, you can go all the way into that ischium is a bone in the thigh, and so on. So basically, you don't need to go into all these details. I'm just telling you how to study, right? That is a method to study. So anything, like it can be very specific thing also. Like suppose saccharide. So saccharide is something that comes from if you go all the way. It basically saccharide means sugar or carbohydrate, right? So if you have studied class 11 chemistry, you know this. So sugar or carbohydrate. So saccharide actually comes from Sanskrit. It comes from sharkara, which also gave us shakkar. So this is something where we also get saccharide from, right? So every even technical sounding words have some story behind them. Like it's a very technical word, only used by biologists or med doctors or chemists. But still, it has a pretty interesting etymology if you get at that. So that is there. And then what else can we do? Okay, now there are some falconry etymologies as well. So there are falconry etymologies. So suppose there are idioms also that have etymologies. Let's say fed up, being fed up, right? Being fed up. So suppose cat gives this question. Suppose fed up is used in a passage and it asks you, what does fed up mean in the passage, right? And you have options, right? You have options like the author has eaten fully, and suppose you have another one. The author is tired of doing the same thing, right? So one of them is the literal meaning. This is the literal meaning of fed up, and this is the figurative meaning, right? So most of you know this is a common idiom, fed up. So you know this is correct. This is the correct answer, right? Not this. Not this, right? But suppose you don't know and you have to learn this. So actually, fed up actually comes from falconry practice. So basically, in the Middle Ages, there was a class of people called falconeers who used to, their profession was to tame and train falcons or birds of prey like eagles, falcons, and use them for hunting. So what happened that these falcons, you if you send it for hunting, why will it bring the prey to you? Won't it eat it itself, right? So in order to prevent, they used to train it that, okay, if you bring me, I'll give you a reward. Okay, so basically, they didn't use to feed falcon till it was about to hunt, because if you feed it, it will not do your work. So they didn't feed it. So if it when it did their work, they used to reward it with food. So once they rewarded it with food, it became thankless and stopped doing their work. It has eaten. Now, unless it feels hungry again, it will not do your work. So that's why it's called fed up. Like the falcon is fed up with your work. Now, see, it started with this. The etymological sense is correct. Author has eaten fully. Fed up actually comes from eating. But today, the modern sense has come to be more of this rather than this, right? So even idioms and words change their meaning over time. Etymology is the study of the original sense of the word, right? So etymologically, this is correct, but when you have to mark in the cat, this is the right answer, right? So, but then again, you have to be wary of not always going for the more. Here it was okay, but general rule in cat is if something is not directly stated in the passage, don't assume unless it's so obvious that this is the figurative meaning. So okay, but if the passage it is written that the author has eaten fully, that is the answer. But most probably, it won't be as such. So you get idioms change meaning over the time. There is a very famous quote that says this: a rolling stone gathers no moss, right? So see, originally this single quote meaning has inverted over time. It has turned upon its head, upside down. So earlier, what happened earlier that created the original sense of the word was that a rolling stone no moss. So it originally the see older people, they are more conservative, right? They tend to not encourage new things. So when it meant that you will not learn anything or gain anything, right? If you're restless. But today the world is more dynamic. It is encouraged that you do, the young people do a lot of things, the youth does a lot of things. So today the modern sense, it means if you don't if you sorry if you keep moving, or if you keep if you stay active, you will not gain any if you will not gain any bad things, right? Like moss. So see, here moss was treated as, see, when a stone is rolling, it gathers this moss that is there on the ground, right? So earlier moss was treated as something that is good, right? So if you're restless, if you're a student who is doing this also, that also, that also, you'll never learn one of these. But today the meaning has gone 180 degrees. Now it's something good, like a rolling stone gathers no moss. So if you keep yourself active, you'll not gain any bad thoughts or bad ideas, right? Like it's also said that empty mind is the workshop of the devil. So in the same sense, basically idioms invert meaning over time. So it's very interesting to see. Actually, if you look, the word nice meant something bad long while ago. Nice actually meant terrible, something terrible. And there are other idioms also. The idioms also become easy when you learn the meaning. Saved by the bell. So saved by the bell has two etymologies. One is that it comes from boxing. Like if you're getting if you're losing a ma if you're losing a round, but the bell of the round rings, so you're saved by the bell from being beaten up by your opponent in boxing. So that is one etymology. The second etymology is much more interesting. So there can be com there are always two or three theories that say I am correct, I am correct. You can never be sure which is the interest story of the word. But even if an etymology is wrong, it's very handy to remember it, because once you have the story in your head, even though it is wrong, it helps you, right? It helps you. So pretty simple, like it, okay, it's fine. Even if it's wrong, it helps me remember the word. So even if your etymology is wrong, I don't care. It helps me remember. So very easy with that. So saved by the bell. So saved by the bell, basically, what it meant, see, in ancient times, we didn't have all this medical diagnosis. So just when a person fainted or was unconscious, suppose, what do? You check his pulse, and if pulse is not there, breathing is not there, you say that, okay, this person is dead. You declare him dead. And today, modern science can try to bring back people who have, stopped their heart by giving them CPR or mouth to mouth. It didn't exist a lot back then. So people used to bury them, and sometimes some buried people woke up inside their graves, and they saw, oh, they thought I was dead and they buried me. Now they're trying to claw their way back above, right? So what people realize is that sometimes we bury people who are not actually later. So they start putting a bell in the coffin, right? So this actually comes from a bell in a coffin. So suppose you are in a coffin and you're just unconscious. So you ring that bell, and people will know, okay, this guy is not dead, he is alive. So I'll just, the graveyard in charge, the keeper of the yard, he'll just excavate you out quickly, right? So this is how idioms can also have very interesting etymology. So proverbs, idioms, these enhance your vocabulary, not just words, like phrases and words in figurative senses. These enhance your vocabulary. So it's important to enrich your vocabulary with such learning as well, right? So this is very interesting. It was Halloween, so I thought I would give such an example. Cool. So that is there. I think that's enough for today. So if you like the session, you can drop me a feedback. Even if you didn't like, you can drop me a criticism, and anything is welcome. So thank you so much for attending, and just drop me a feedback and you can leave. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for attending. Hope you attend the next session as well. Yeah. Thank you so much. Keep what I said in mind. Don't focus on my examples. What I have taught you, use it in your life daily. Okay. Unless you use it, my teaching is useless. So just use what I have taught you. Use the rules. Don't go for examples. Don't go for instances. Try to draw generalizations. Learn hundreds of words together in classes instead of learning specific words. Okay. All that. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'll end the meeting now. It was great. Great. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Hope you attend the next session as well. And you can contact me. I'm the person who is calling everyone. Okay. You can contact me there. You have, most of you have my number, I guess. So you can ask me anything, anytime. And yeah. Okay. Have a good day. Good. Thank you. Good night. Good night, everyone. Thank you so much.